Does the Holy Spirit indwell Christians today? Why do some Christians believe the Holy Spirit only lives in the Word? Let me read that again. Does the Holy Spirit indwell Christians today? Why do some Christians believe the Holy Spirit only lives in the Word? The answer is, to the first question, is yes. In response to the second question, I would change it just a little bit. I would say that some of our brothers and sisters, some teachers that I respect greatly, believe that the Holy Spirit only works through the Word. Not lives, but works. Big difference between lives and works. But I think that's the spirit of the question. So that's how I'm going to answer, try to answer the question. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. First Corinthians makes this statement that we're about to read in chapter 6 two different times in a little bit different way, but they're both, for the purposes of what we're doing tonight, they're both roughly the same. Verse 19 of 1 Corinthians 6 says, "Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own? You have been bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body." Your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit whom you have from God. Does the Holy Spirit dwell within you? The answer for Christians? Yes. And we don't have time to look at all the verses on this, but there are verses in the New Testament that teach if you don't have, and we'll look at them here in a second, but there's several of them that teach if you don't have the Holy Spirit, then you don't have Christ. Let's go to Romans chapter 8. This is what I was referencing a minute ago. Romans chapter 8. I'm going to give you the answer to the question, and then we're going to back up and give some clarification and limiting observations as well. Romans chapter 8, beginning in verse 9. However, you are, let me just take a minute here. Romans chapter 8 is one of my favorite chapters in the Bible. Romans chapter 8 helped me understand the relationship with God almost more than any other, a personal relationship with God, almost more than any other passage that I can think of. Verse 5 says, "For those who are according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, those who are according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For the mind set on the flesh is death, but the mind set on the Spirit is life and peace." If I'm going to preach one time, one place, and I can preach anything I want to, I'm very likely to preach on that. Because I think it is some of the most important thing about setting your mind on the Spirit and having a spiritual mindset. I think it is a key. To me, it's the clearest explanation in my own life of what I'm supposed to be doing and how I'm supposed to be thinking. But that's the context. That's what's going on in Romans chapter 8. You come down to verse 9. "However, you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. But if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to him." Okay? Spirit of God dwells in you. If you don't have the Spirit of Christ, you don't belong to Christ. "If Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, yet the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. So then, brethren, we are under obligation not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you are living according to the flesh, you must die. But if by the Spirit you are putting to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. For you have not received the spirit of slavery leading to fear again, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by which we cry out, Abba, problem. So you see, this is a detailed discussion on the Holy Spirit. But if you look there, verse 14 is what I was talking about earlier. All who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. Now, if that's all you've got, it's easy to think to yourself, okay, the Holy Spirit dwells in me. He's leading me. Therefore, I need to pay attention to the leading that He gives to me and obey it, because it's the Holy Spirit talking to me and leading me from inside of me. It's very easy to think that. Just read it, Romans 8:14. This is why it's helpful to read a bunch of other passages on the Holy Spirit, because there are a lot of other passages that explain to us more what the Spirit does and how the Spirit goes about doing what He does. Now, I'm not going to pretend I can tell you everything the Spirit does or how the Spirit does what He does. But I can give you some more passages that shed light on it. But we must not be afraid of admitting that the Bible teaches the Holy Spirit dwells in us. We cannot shy away from the fact that that's what the Word of God says. Well, that's what the Word of God says. So let's not be afraid. It's a good thing. Let's try to understand it to the extent that we can understand it. But let's be careful and not get confused into thinking it means something that it doesn't mean. Let me tell you a story of a preacher that I heard about recently. I heard an interview and a long story about this guy. And they've also made his story into, I don't know if it's a movie or if it's a limited series of three or four episodes. I think it's a movie. But he's an African-American preacher, not a brother in Christ. An African-American preacher in Oklahoma. Went to Oral Roberts University, became a close confidant of Oral Roberts himself. Grew up in an African-American Pentecostal type tradition where they were casting out demons and performing miracles and things like that. And I don't even know how to phrase it because it brings up so many things. But he starts a congregation in Oklahoma and it grows into the thousands, like 4,000 or 5,000 members. Huge group of people who are coming to this guy. And I heard him tell the story in his own voice. He's watching the news one day, and this is more than a decade ago, maybe 2 decades ago. But he's watching the news one day, and they're showing a story about starving children in Africa. And he's talking about seeing their swollen bellies and the flies crawling on their face. And we used to see this kind of stuff on the news a lot. We don't see it much anymore. And he says, I prayed to God. This is a man who believes that he's miraculously indwelled by the Holy Spirit. He says, I prayed to God, and I said, God, these people are dying at 1,000 a day. How could you send them to hell? And he said, God said, well, you go. You do something about it. And he says, I can't go. I've got too much going right here. I've got too many people who depend on me. How could you send these people to hell? And God said, I'm not sending them to hell. They're already in hell. And so he takes this as a revelation that God has told him there is no hell. And he goes out and he starts telling us. And he starts preaching. And he gets into a lot of trouble. And people start criticizing him. And people who've been his friends. And people who've been members at the church that he's the head of. Start leaving in droves, and his gigantic church building gets foreclosed on, and his life just sort of crumbles. That's not important to the story for us, what we're talking about tonight. What we're talking about tonight is the difference between being dwelled in by the Holy Spirit and getting miraculous revelation from God. Those are two different things. They are not the same. And this man illustrates the importance of understanding the difference. Because when you think that the Holy Spirit is giving you personal revelation from God, and you're not getting your understanding of what God wants and God's will from the Word of God, you're going to make a huge mistake, just like that man. And he was already making plenty of mistakes, but he made it a lot worse. So what does it mean that we're indwelled in the Holy Spirit? We're going to come back here to Romans chapter 8, but I want you to go with me to Ezekiel. I want to look at a prophecy from the Old Testament that God makes that I think foretells of the Holy Spirit. And I think it is really good for us to understand the implication of what it means. Ezekiel 36. I hope I already said that. Ezekiel chapter 36, beginning in verse 26, where God is prophesying to the Israelites through the prophet Ezekiel. And he's telling them what the future will hold. He says, "Moreover, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will be careful to observe my ordinances." Okay. New heart, new spirit, God's spirit within you. Okay? That's the promise. That's the prophecy. I will give you a new heart. I'll remove your heart of stone, give you a new heart of flesh, give you a new spirit, my spirit. Okay, I think that's clearly talking about the Holy Spirit. What does that do? What effect does it have when God puts that heart and that spirit within you? Right there at the end of verse 27. "Cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will be careful to observe my ordinances." That new spirit and that new heart is not going to give you new information. It's going to give you a desire to do what God said. Do you see how important that is? We often talk about the Holy Spirit and conscience. We talk about the Holy Spirit and how he affects the way we look at things. Well, your desire to do what God said, your guilt, your feeling bad when you don't do what God said, that's having the heart and the spirit that God wants you to have. That's the operation of God on your inside. Now, second part of this question was, why do some Christians believe the Holy Spirit only lives in the Word, or as I said, only works in the Word? 1 John chapter 5, at the end of verse 6, says, "It is the Spirit who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth." Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Jesus says that he is the truth. 1 John 5, verse 6 says, the Holy Spirit is the truth. Here's the way I would explain that. Here's the way it makes sense to me. You can't separate Jesus from the Word of God. And you can't separate the Holy Spirit from the Word of God. Jesus, when he prophesied the Holy Spirit coming to the apostles, John 14, again in John 15, again in John 16, about four different times he prophesied in those three chapters that he's going to send the Holy Spirit to them. To the apostles, the Holy Spirit was going to guide them into all the truth. He was going to take from Jesus and give it to them. He was going to remind them of everything Jesus has said. And he's called the Spirit of Truth. The Holy Spirit and the Word of God are inseparable. Now, the Holy Spirit is a divine being. It's not ink on a page. It's not just an idea. But it is the source of the Word of God. And so, the effect that the Word of God has on you is also an effect that the Holy Spirit is having on you, because the Spirit is the truth, just like Jesus is the truth. And so in that sense, you can't separate what the Word does from what the Spirit does. And having the Spirit dwell in you in no way demotes the importance of the written Word. In no way. The written Word is every bit as important to your salvation and your relationship with God as it was. Okay. An example. A lot of times, the Bible will say the Holy Spirit does something, and then in another place it will say the Word does something. And that's really where a lot of our brothers and sisters come to this conclusion that the Holy Spirit only works through the Word. For instance, this morning in the sermon we talked about John chapter 3, verse 5. One must be born of the water and the Spirit. Unless one is born of the water and the Spirit, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. Well, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23 says, "For you have been born again, not of seed which is perishable, but imperishable, through the living and abiding Word of God." John 3, verse 5, "You're born again in the Spirit." 1 Peter 1:23, "You're born again in the Word." But you see, the Spirit and the Word are inseparable. Another example. John chapter 16, when Jesus is prophesying that the Holy Spirit will come, he says, verse 8, John 16, verse 8, "And he, when he comes, will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment." The Holy Spirit will convict the world concerning sin, righteousness, and judgment. Romans 6, verse 17, says, "But thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, you became obedient from the heart to that form of teaching to which you were committed, and having been freed from sin, you became slaves of righteousness." So there we have people going from sin, being convicted about sin, and becoming righteous. And the Holy Spirit will convict the world concerning sin, righteousness, and judgment. In Romans 6, it's teaching. It's not the Holy Spirit, it's the Word. John 16, it's the Holy Spirit. There's nothing. The Holy Spirit does it through the Word. And so, you could easily say to yourself, and rightfully so, "Well, when I don't follow the Word of God, when I don't do what I know the Word of God tells me to do, I feel guilty. I feel bad about it." And the reason I feel bad about it is because I want to have a good relationship with God. I want to be with God for eternity, and I know what the Word of God says, and I know what the consequences can be if I don't follow the Word of God. And that's just a logical process in my brain from having read God's Word and making the link to my behavior. There's nothing miraculous about that. The Word did that, right? The Word inspired by the Holy Spirit. Can you distinguish the logical process, the conditioning of your mind from following the Word of God, studying the Bible, understanding the Bible, from the work of the Holy Spirit? You can't. You cannot. Are they the same? Maybe. Can I say that definitely? No, because the Bible doesn't answer that question. But you see, the Holy Spirit and the Word do the same thing over and over and over again. But the Holy Spirit also is an actual presence of God. God is omnipresent. He is everywhere, all the time, at the same time. He transcends space and time. Revelation chapter 1, and then several more chapters after that, talk about the seven spirits of God These seven spirits go out into the whole earth. They're sometimes the seven spirits of God, the seven eyes and the seven horns, which are the seven spirits of God. They see everything. In Revelation, the Holy Spirit seems to be the method of God's omnipresence. And I know that's theoretical and hard to understand. Go back with me to Romans chapter 8. I said we were going to come back to Romans chapter 8, and we're going to stop here so that we don't get too quick. Romans chapter 8, Romans chapter 8, we've already looked at verses 9 through 15, but come down to verse 26. In the same way, the Spirit also helps our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And He who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because He intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. Couple of companion passages. Ephesians 2:18, for through Him, talking about the Spirit, for through Him we both have our access in one Spirit to the Father. We have access to the Father through prayer, through the Spirit. Jude 20, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. Romans 8:26 and 27 teaches us that God searches our hearts, searches our minds. The Holy Spirit searches our hearts, searches our minds, intercedes for us, understands our deepest groanings, the presence of God in our life. Not miraculous. Not giving you special revelation. Not telling you things any different than what you learn from the Bible. But God is present in your life through the Holy Spirit. And He's present in prayers, and your prayers go through His mediation. He is the medium of our prayer. And so, does the Holy Spirit dwell in us? Yes. Does He work only through the Word? Not through prayer. Prayer is at least one exception to that. I'm not going to limit anything that He does, except I'm going to believe Him when He told us that miracles can cease. And miracles have ceased, and He is not giving you or me or anybody else miraculous power or miraculous revelation. I'm glad that He lives in me, but what change that makes, I really don't know. But I'm glad He's here, and I'm glad He's helping me in my prayers. I hope you find that helpful. I hope you don't find it confusing. If you do, I'm happy to talk to you about it to try to clarify what I have made unclear.